Okay, so here is what Bernoulli's principle says. There is a strange mix of quantities which, if you add them all together, it is conserved for a fluid. So we have a, kind of the strange kind of list of quantities. You have a pressure, then we have kinetic energy per unit volume, or as I call it, kinetic energy density. It's basically your stand-in for kinetic energy, except instead of 1/2 mv², m, what does that mean for a fluid, because there's m coming in and going out all the time. So it's kinetic energy per unit volume. And then this similarly is, instead of good old mgh, this is density times gh, it's the potential energy per unit volume, or potential energy density in the fluid. Now, for us, if we're doing a calculation, we do it usually with a liquid, where the density doesn't change. I think you might have one on the homework where it's air, so then you're going to have to just assume that the air density doesn't change. And if that's the case, there's only really three active ingredients: pressure, speed, and height. So those are the things that have to trade amongst each other in some way. They can't all increase or all decrease, because that would be violating Bernoulli's principle, which is that this quantity as a whole is conserved. So let's tackle an example, a numerical example. You have several of these on your homework. And the purpose of this example is to try to work in lots of different things so that there's nothing really that can surprise you. So I'm going to go ahead, put a big water tank like this, put it on stilts. Let's say that the water tank is 4 meters above the ground, and then 5 meters deep. It's a large tank with a small hole, and I'll talk about why that's important, that it's a large tank relative to a small hole. Water is going to come out of that hole, it's going to go down to the bottom here, and I want to know how fast is it going when it hits the ground. Believe it or not, that's all the information I need to solve this problem, is how high is the tank above the ground and how deep is the water in that tank. So let's go ahead and set this up by picking 2 points in the fluid and having that this quantity is conserved. So obviously we want to be, this is kind of like energy conservation, in that you want to pick your 2 points that you're going to compare very carefully so that you can actually do something. I think fairly obviously the final point is going to be over here, right? That's my final point of interest. And my initial point, there's actually several good choices. One of the choices I'm going to make, and I'll show you others, I'm going to pick the initial point right about there. So let's go ahead and set those 2 points, and we'll set this quantity equal. All right. So I guess let's go ahead and start with potential energy first. As usual, we set h equals 0 as the lowest height of interest, so that obviously in this problem is right about there. So then, which height would be 0?
Final.
Yep. What would be my initial height there?
4.
That'll be my initial height, 4 meters. Okay, so that takes care of the potential energy term. I guess let's move to the velocity term, or the kinetic energy term. Of course, the final speed is what I'm trying to find. Now, the initial speed, this is where the large tank small hole comes in. Because if you have a gigantic tank with a tiny little leak in it, what is basically the speed of the water in nearly all of the tank?
0,
exactly. So if I just make sure that this initial point is not right next to the hole, I can basically say that the water is stationary there, right? I can't be perfectly stationary because, of course, as water comes out the hole, the water needs to go come in to replace it. But for all intents and purposes, that's the beauty of a large tank, small hole. So basically, all of my velocity that's non-zero is going to be very close to the hole. And everything else, the water is going to be moving imperceptibly slowly. So I'm going to approximate this as zero. I just make sure my initial point is set back far enough from the hole so that the water is moving very slowly. Okay, so that's my kinetic energy term. Let's talk about the pressure. What is the pressure out here in the air? Atmospheric pressure, right? You're basically just out in the air. That's atmospheric pressure. Is the pressure at the bottom of the tank atmospheric? No, definitely not. You're under some water, so you definitely have a larger pressure. Luckily, we have a formula for that, right? So our formula is PATM plus rho G times the depth. So what should I use for that depth? 5 meters. Make sure you know the difference between the d is depth below the surface, that's 5 meters. That's not the same as h is your good old potential energy. H is h measured as a height above some reference height. Usually the h equals zero, we set the lowest head of interest. So when we're at the bottom of the tank, we're 4 meters above that. Now that's a lot of stuff plugged in, so let me kind of just recopy it. What do I have? PATM plus rho g, and I guess I'll put in the depth, 5. That's zero, this is rho g4, PATM, looks like that. Now I know that looks a little bit awkward there with some of the numbers at the end, but I'll leave it like that, there's nothing wrong with it, it just looks a little bit funky. Let's see. I can actually add these are like terms. So 5 stuff plus 4 stuff is 9 stuff, right? So let me write that down next. This looks weird that it's numbers at the end, but hopefully that doesn't disturb your mathematical equilibrium or anything. There's that. What could I do next? Take off atmospheric pressure from both sides. That very commonly happens, by the way. Atmospheric pressure is kind of like the baseline you can't really get away from, right? You can be at atmospheric pressure, or if you're at the bottom of the tank, you can be at atmospheric pressure plus some more, right? So this will very commonly cancel. The pressure differences all come from the gauge pressure, right? So it comes from the fact that this pressure is more than atmospheric, right? So there's your gauge pressure. That's how the pressure is modified from atmospheric when you're at the bottom of the tank. And then, of course, you come from that out to just atmospheric. All right, what do we have left? So we've subtracted PATM off both sides. How about what we can do is divide both sides by density, yep. Now we're pretty much done. Bring over the 2. 9 times 2 is 18, g, so we have an answer. That should come out to be, I believe, around 13.3 meters per second. There's your answer. So hopefully you kind of proceed similarly to an energy conservation problem. It's just this weird set of quantities which includes pressure as well in your conservation. Now, that is definitely not the only good initial choice. Let me show you another one. Let me say instead, I pick this point. This would be like an alternate choice for the initial point. Let's see how that would work out. So my alternate initial point, P initial plus 1/2 rho V initial squared Let's see how that would work out. What's the pressure up there?
Atmospheric pressure. I'm at the surface, right?
What would be the speed up there?
Zero. Now, yes, the water level is dropping very slowly, because if water comes out the hole, then it has to also be draining from the bottom, so the water has to drop, but I'm going to approximate that zero. Large tank, small hole. What about the height there? What should I use for the height?
9,
right?
So that's rho g times 9. So it's the same as this, so why bother going any further, right? PATM plus rho g9. I get the same answer. There is no right or wrong for which one of those initial points is better. The only thing I'd recommend to you is don't pick a point somewhere in the middle, because that would just be silly, right? So a point somewhere in the middle, it would have less potential energy, right, because it's lower, but it'd have more pressure. But the sum of the three would still be the same, right? So these are, I think, the two most logical initial points. Not that the other ones are wrong, but they're just more work for you. In fact, this kind of leads me into a discussion about the conservation as a whole. As we go from here down to here, out to here, and down here, we can talk about, as the quantity is conserved, which of the terms is it more sloshed to? Now, what is the most dominant term of the three here? Is it the pressure, kinetic energy, or potential energy? That's the potential energy, right? So the pressure, the gauge pressure is zero here, right? You're just at atmospheric pressure. Your kinetic energy term is zero. It's all potential energy, right? So it's sloshed very highly favored toward that term, right? Now, then we go to the bottom of the tank, right? At the bottom of the tank, I guess I should probably label these, so I'll call this A, B, C, D, okay? So at point B, our kinetic energy is still zero, right? But now, we have less potential energy than before. Where is it now?
Pressure.
Pressure. You have the biggest pressure you're going to have in this problem at the bottom of the tank, right? So you've sloshed it more toward the pressure term. Let's go to point C. Now, point C, we go back to atmospheric pressure or zero gauge pressure, but we're still at the same potential energy as we were at point B, right? So we haven't changed height. So if you went down on pressure, where does it all go then? Kinetic energy. So between points B and C, the pressure decreases, the kinetic energy increases. So you're going very fast as you exit the hole. Think of it, this is what Bernoulli's is for. It allows us to characterize what happens with a pressure difference as a conservation. So we have very large pressure inside, pushing out against atmospheric pressure, so we trade our pressure for speed, right? The high pressure becomes high speed, right? So, does that make sense? If you want to think of it in the force picture, you can think of high pressure pushing against a lower pressure wind. So that's the net force that accelerates the fluid to very high speed. Bernoulli's is just nice because it allows us to say that if the pressure decreases, the speed increases. It's like a conservation. And then finally, for point D, of course, as you move from point C to point D, the pressure is out of it. The gauge pressure is zero, which is atmospheric pressure. Does the fluid speed up from C to D? Yes, it does. The kinetic energy increases even more. Where does it get that from? Gravity, right? Because this is finally, we've taken all the energy away from the gravitational stored form. So you speed up even more from C to D, but it has nothing to do with the pressure difference. It has to do with just falling down. Just like a baseball falls down and goes faster, so will these water molecules. So you can see it's just a conservation trading between one thing and another. The only difference is that you can put it in this weird third thing, which is a pressure. So normally if we drop something, let's say we drop it, we take a chunk of water and we drop it. Well, there it just trades kinetic energy, potential energy. In fact, you'd find if you dropped it from a height of 9 meters, you'd find that the speed is this. There it just trades straight up between potential energy and kinetic energy. So that's kind of one of the tricks of Bernoulli's, is you can imagine just taking the water out and dropping it. The only difference with Bernoulli's is that here, of course, you'd be going substantially faster than when you dropped it. But here, at this height, it's still going zero like it did here. And the reason why is that it's not going from kinetic energy into, or potential energy into kinetic, it's going from potential energy into pressure, right? So we have another place to tuck away the energy. Instead of just having it get converted from potential energy into kinetic energy, we can put it into pressure instead. So this point B is higher pressure than point A. It's not going any faster though. So there's a little bit of a look at Bernoulli's in the quantitative sense. Are there any questions on that? Yeah?
So the final velocity of the water coming out of the barrel, wouldn't it only be the y component that's going to speed up? Because if you threw a baseball, it'd go the same speed until it hit something else, right?
That's the projectile motion, right? Is if you throw something, then the x component is constant. The horizontal component, the y component increases, which means that the speed as a whole increases, right? So remember, energy doesn't, you don't have to break things up into components, right? Energy just deals with total speed. That's the beauty of 1/2 mv² at mgh, is that it doesn't care at all about direction. It just deals in height and total speed, right? So if you're just trying to figure out how fast it goes when it hits the ground, all you have to do is know what height it fell through.